Hello everyone, today in our series of Docplexus KOL interviews, we have with us Dr. Chitra Venkatasubramanian, who is a board certified neurologist, vascular neurologist and neurocritical care physician. Her main interest areas are in brain hemorrhage, usual, unusual and rare causes of stroke, cerebral venous thrombosis and anticoagulation management after strokes. Her research focuses on the study of brain edema and tissue perfusion in intracerebral hemorrhage using novel MRI techniques and biomarkers. She is the Stanford principal investigator for several clinical trials in intracerebral hemorrhage. Thank you so much, Dr. Chitra, for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
So, you are a neurocritical care physician. Can you just elaborate on the specialty?
Sure. So, neurocritical care is actually a subspecialty of neurology. It's what we call a pretty young subspecialty. It's been around for about 15 years or so. It's under the organization of International Neurocritical Care Society. And I practice in the United States, and about 10% of our neurocritical care trainees and physicians are of Indian origin. So it seems to be a very popular subspecialty among Indians. So what we do as neurointensivists is we are all board certified neurologists. Some of us do stroke neurology as well, but we primarily work in the intensive care unit, and it can be in any intensive care unit or specifically in a neurointensive care unit. And the kinds of patients that we take care of are those who have very large ischemic strokes, patients who have brain hemorrhages, subarachnoid hemorrhages, aneurysms, very bad head traumas, patients who are comatose. Anybody who has a neurological reason to be in the intensive care unit, we provide, you know, very complete care of them. And in the United States, the way it works is we perform as a critical care physician, meaning we intubate them, we do echocardiograms for them, we put in all the lines, axes, and we also function as a neurologist. So it's kind of a combination of medicine and neurology.
So what is the impact of early intervention on outcomes of patients with traumatic brain injury?
That's a great question. So we, you know, like to classify traumatic brain injury into mild, moderate, and severe. And even if somebody has had a very mild injury, like a concussion, they can have long-lasting cognitive issues. For example, if you're a very high-functioning individual like a doctor, it's hard for you to go back to work and be as sharp as you've been. And this is even for sort of mild traumatic brain injury. But when we talk about moderate and severe, the impact is quite significant. So in the intensive care unit, you know, after the first few days of stabilizing them, we start very aggressive rehabilitation right in the intensive care unit. And this rehabilitation is in the form of physical therapy, occupational therapy, speech therapy. Everything starts right there in the intensive care. We get these patients up sitting at the side of the bed. We even have them, you know, walking around if they can walk. Sometimes they're attached to the ventilator, so they're walking around with the ventilator. And we find that getting patients out of bed as quickly as we can and moving them towards a normal life, in other words, very early rehabilitation, really gives them the best chance to recover from their brain injury.
So what do you suggest about the prognostic value for corticospinal tract Wallerian degeneration in intracerebral hemorrhage?
So that actually is one of my research interests, and I'm glad you asked me about it. So this study that we did is one of the most, let me backtrack, one of the most common questions that we get asked is, how is my loved one going to do? Are they going to survive? And if we say yes, they're going to survive, the next question is, what kind of problems are they going to have? Are they going to be able to talk? Are they able to walk? Will they be able to move one side? And particularly for brain hemorrhages, not a lot of research was done about it. So we actually did a study where we took patients with brain hemorrhages. We did MRI scans for them every week. This is only as part of a research study. And we were trying to identify features on the MRI that can give us physicians a little more insight into how these patients would do 6 months down the road or 1 year down the road. And on the MRI, we found that we can see on this sequence called diffusion-weighted imaging along the corticospinal tract coming from the internal capsule to the brainstem, if they are going to have residual defects on the opposite side where they cannot move their arm or leg, we find that this the corticospinal pathway starts becoming bright very early on. And so using that, we are able to prognosticate to some extent, but more importantly, we can use that as a biomarker to come up with therapies that will minimize the damage to the corticospinal tract so we can get our patients up and walking again.
So how can we spread knowledge about clinical impact of perihematomal edema associated with intracerebral hemorrhage?
Right. So again, most of my research work has been in intracerebral hemorrhages. So when you have bleeding in the brain, the way I like to explain it to my patients is, you know, imagine you're like being hit on the hand and you have a bruise. And after you have bruising, there's swelling, and the swelling is there for 5 or 7 days and then it starts going away. And we wanted to know, after you have blood in the brain, when does the swelling start? How long does the swelling start? And what impact does the swelling have on top of the brain hemorrhage? So you've already had a brain hemorrhage. Now, does the brain edema or swelling make an additional effect on how these patients recover? So the first thing we found is that what used to be thought is that you develop brain swelling and it goes away after 5-6 days. And we found that's not actually the case, that you can have brain swelling for up to 2 weeks. So 10 days to 2 weeks, you can have brain swelling. And what causes this brain swelling is the presence of blood in the brain. So the latest research and the latest therapies are to see how we can reduce the inflammation that happens around the brain hemorrhage, because it's that inflammation from all the blood products that are breaking down that's causing the swelling. So one of the studies that I work on is called IDEF. It's desferoxamine. It's a very commonly available chelating agent. It's used to take off iron from the body. So we are trying that to see, hey, can we take out the iron from the brain hemorrhage, and maybe these patients will have less swelling, you know, compared to the others. The other kind of research is to use minimally invasive catheters to suck out the blood clot, as opposed to making a big opening in the skull and then taking it out, just like a very small hole, put a catheter in and aspirate or suck out the blood clot. And at least early results show that by doing that, we can actually reduce the amount of swelling, can reduce the amount of inflammation, and these patients get back and recover much faster.
So do you think progesterone is useful for the treatment of traumatic brain injury?
It worked for rats. It didn't unfortunately work. It actually worked very well for like female rats and for pregnant rats because, you know, they have the most progesterone. But once we translated that from, you know, the lab into the clinical realm, and there were two very big studies that were done, probably some of the biggest studies in traumatic brain injury. And unfortunately, it didn't seem to help. So we don't know why it didn't work, either because we gave it too late, you know, after the brain edema or the brain injury happened. Maybe we didn't give a adequate number of dose, or maybe we didn't choose the right patients to give it to, because every, if you have a head injury, every head injury is different than the other head injury. So maybe we needed to focus on a specific type of head injury and not every type of head injury. So we're not really sure, but unfortunately it worked great in rats, but it didn't work in like humans.
So do you think an online platform of doctors like Docplexus can help spread awareness about this new specialty like neurocritical care?
Yeah, I absolutely think so, because, you know, one of the first things is, at least for me, because I'm a neurocritical care physician, I want more people to do this. So my interest is to bring enthusiasm to this field, because it's such a cool field. Even though you're not a neurosurgeon, you can actually behave like one. You know, you do so many procedures in the intensive care unit. And I don't think, you know, it has to be only the anesthesiologists who do it. The neurologists can also do it. They can also learn how to do it. And so one of my missions is to invite young people to come and join our field and really provide like the best care you can, you know, for our patients. And, you know, online platforms like Docplexus, by, you know, having interviews with people like me and, you know, having articles and write-ups and, you know, synopsizing the news, you guys can create so much awareness of this.
We really hope that the specialty becomes a major specialty soon. Yes. And thank you so much, Dr. Chitra, for joining us today for this interview and sharing your valuable time and knowledge with us.
Sure, sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you. To stay updated on our latest KOL videos and interviews, please follow us on Twitter, like us on our Facebook page, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Happy Docplexing!